All right. It looks like we've got the vast majority of everybody in from the waiting room. Thanks so much for joining us. We're going to get things started off here so that we can look to keep on time today. Our plan is to meet from now until about 1:15 this afternoon. So I would like to kick things off by welcoming you all to our second Rise Up Calgary Relaunch lunch. The purpose of these lunches is to bring together folks from the arts community, from the entertainment and hospitality industries to look at new ways of doing things in the times that we find ourselves in. And it's an opportunity for us to talk about things that have worked so far that colleagues and others have been trying out, new ideas, new opportunities, and hopefully engage you all to think about ways that you might be able to do things within your organization as organizations, as individual artists, and connect to collaborate for new ideas moving ahead. So hopefully everybody has a lunch with them to spend this next hour and munch away while we talk. My name is Sherry McMaster, and I'm a consultant with Bird Creatives and Rise Up Calgary. And we also have three panelists joining us. You'll see them on the screen here. I'll introduce them shortly. Additionally, we have Brenda joining us, who's our ASL interpreter, and you can see her on the screen as well. The speakers and the interpreter will be set up on your screen so that they can remain featured. And we ask as guests that you keep your microphones muted unless you're speaking. It just contributes to the overall audio quality of the conversation. The other thing that we have going on today is captioning services. You'll see at the top there's a live on Otter AI link across the top. If you'd like to use that, you can click on that button and it will activate it. What you would do is choose View Stream on Otter AI Notes, and that will open an additional browser where you'll see the live transcription. Also joining us on the call today is Ben Nixon. You'll see Ben in the list of participants there. Ben is helping with all things tech. So should you have any issues during the meeting with audio or video, you can chat with him and he'll be able to help you out. To activate the chat function, you'll see the icon on the bottom of your screen. If you just click on that, you can chat to the entire group, or you can also send a private message to chat with anyone. And when we do open things up for Q&A, you can either unmute yourself and talk to us and be on camera if you wish, or if you would prefer just to type in your questions, you can use the chat function for that, or the raise hand function, which is located underneath the participants tab. So that's all of the pieces there. Also, just want to note to everyone that this meeting is being recorded so we can keep it for archival purposes. So before I get to the introductions of our wonderful panelists, I'd like to acknowledge where we're gathered today. Today we find ourselves living in this balance between a virtual world and a physical world. And most of the people here on the call today, as well as Rise Up Calgary, is based here in Calgary, Mokinstis, as it's traditionally known. This is the heart of Treaty 7 territory. It is the home of the Kainai, Piikani, Siksika, Tsuut'ina, Stoney Nakoda Nations, and Métis Nation Region 3. And Calgary is at the confluence of the Bow River and the Elbow River, which has been a gathering place for generations, for centuries, for people to come together and share traditions, share their teachings, share their arts and their culture and their stories. And in that spirit of building community, we welcome everyone here today. We give gratitude to those who have come before us and show gratitude to this land that we all share and call home. So let's get to our wonderful panelists. I'd like to introduce you to a great group of arts and community building professionals. First off, we have Teresa Byrne. Teresa is from the city of Calgary. She is a born and raised Calgarian, and a significant portion of her career has been working for the city in the Arts and Culture Division to make Calgary a better place for all. She has a theater background, including educational experience at Mount Royal College, and has worked for various nonprofit organizations, including the design chair of the Creative Kids Museum, as an event coordinator for the Arts and Culture Division for the City of Calgary, where she supported the development of many of the major festivals that have happened here in this city, and as the Arts and Culture Superintendent, where she led a group of coordinators and specialists to provide guidance and support for over 300 major festivals, including Canada Day, Culture Days, and New Year's Eve. And her current role is as the Special Projects Manager for the city, which is focused on developing a strategic and collaborative approach on how festivals and events are supported and managed and delivered here in the city. The next panelist that we have is Jennifer Rempel. Jennifer Rempel joins us, wears many hats, but also most recently from the Calgary Downtown Association. She spent many years with the 4th Street Business Revitalization Zone as their executive director, producing Lilac Festival, which over 19 years grew in its attendance by over 100,000 guests. In 2017, she left that role to focus on her own event production company, and her knack for organizing events has led her to organize, in addition to Lilac Festival, Festival Latin Festival, the Inglewood Sunfest, the Inglewood Night Markets, the Taste of Calgary, Canada Day at Eau Claire Market, and most recently she created MexiFest. And most recently on her putting a bit of a hiatus on her own production company, she has joined the Calgary Downtown Association as their new general manager. So welcome to Jennifer. The next panelist that we have is Patti Pon. Patti joins us from Calgary Arts Development. There she is, the president and CEO, and is a veteran of the community and arts champion. She's got an extensive track record of leadership and service here in the city. She's served as senior leadership positions at the EPCOR Centre, which is now Arts Commons, the Alberta Performing Arts Stabilization Fund, and Alberta Theatre Projects, among others. She's just completed her first full term on the board of the Calgary Foundation and also serves on a committee for the Calgary Stampede. She's a founding member, board member of the Canadian Heritage Foundation Southern Alberta, and has served on steering committees for Imagine Calgary, as well as the board of CKUA Radio Network. She's been with Calgary Arts Development as their CEO since 2013, and has led the organization through the process of doubling its budget in 2019. She's also won several awards, including the Queen Elizabeth II Diamond Jubilee Medal, and the 2013 Harry and Martha Cohen Award, recognizing contributions to Calgary Theatre's theatre community. So welcome to Patti. And to steer this conversation this afternoon, Kaylee Bicycle is joining us. Kaylee is the principal consultant of Bird Creatives and is the project manager for Rise Up Calgary. And so with that, with a welcome to our panelists, I'd like to pass it over to Kaylee to get the conversation on micro festivals, how they could work, how we could reimagine a summer festival season, and how folks might be able to collaborate together. So over to you, Kaylee.
Thank you, Sherry. As Sherry so eloquently put, you know, these Rise Up Relaunch lunches are all about collaboration. How do we work together to reimagine what we can do to get back to the events and the festivals and the gatherings that we're all missing so much? And so obviously it's going to have to continue to look differently for a while here, but hopefully we can do something in a way that at least gives us some sense of that connection and being able to reconnect with the arts and the festivals that we've been missing so much. And so with that spirit, I just want to jump into it because this was an idea that was pitched to me by Patti. And Patty's saying, you know, I was talking to Jennifer and we really think there's a way to make this work. And so I really just wanted to throw it to Patti and Jennifer and say, what was the initial inspiration for this idea? And why is it so important that we're having this conversation now? And either one of you can jump in.
Okay, well, maybe I'll jump in quickly and then hand it over to Jen. As Sherry described, Jen is relatively new to her role at the Calgary Downtown Association and the relationship with other BIAs, business improvement areas throughout the rest of the city, but she is no stranger to festivals. And as we started to talk about the impact of COVID, particularly on the arts sector, we started to talk about, you know, how we all thought this was going to be a few weeks and then maybe it might be a few months, but we'd still have our festival season in 2020. And here we are. And we don't know where we will be in the future. The uncertainty remains. I don't know if some of you saw the news this morning. I heard that there is an estimate from an Alberta perspective that for the vaccinations, we will likely have 30% of the population vaccinated by the fall of 2021. And that ideally with vaccination, you have 60% of a population vaccinated to really kind of give yourself some comfort and confidence around safety. So in the context of this conversation, what does that mean for festival season 2021? And of course I'm referencing that when the weather is nice and we can be outside, but I certainly know, and I see many of your faces and your names, you hold festivals throughout the year. So I don't want to dismiss at all that there are festivals that take place year round. But just having that conversation with Jen, maybe we can't have a festival season like we knew it pre-2020. But that doesn't mean we can't have a festival season. That doesn't mean we can't have festivals. And so she and I started riffing, and then I thought about the relaunch lunches, and lo and behold, here we all are. So maybe, Jen, I'll hand off to you to share some of your thoughts.
So thanks, Patti. Yeah, so when I first jumped into this role, Patti and I had an opportunity to connect, and we started talking about what festival season could look like, even in 2020, not knowing we'd be here in the fall. And just thinking about large gatherings, but how to stagger those large gatherings into larger places. And so what if we transformed vacant parking lots into tented experiences with a capacity of 200 and had people move along? Or what if we use spaces in multiple locations to gather people to get them to explore different areas? And then working with the BIAs and the business community to use some of that private property land or those vacant space, retail spaces that exist now into landlords and connecting with the business community on a greater level who are looking for opportunities to partner, and how can we engage in that in creative ways? And so those are where Patti and I started, and it led me down another angle, even with, I continue to produce the Inglewood Night Market. And so what we did is we took some parking lots in Inglewood instead of the streets, and we were able to contain those parking lots, and we were able to capture and maximize our attendance and sell tickets instead of being free, but we made the tickets, you know, inexpensive, and also donated some of that money back to Music Mile, and people came and participated, and we were still able to pay our artist fees, have artisans exhibit, and be quite successful. And it was just a different way of thinking about how we implement our usual recipe, as I call it.
Thanks, Jennifer. And I did want to just take a minute to say, you know, I've got some set questions here, but we really do want to hear from all of you. And so if you have a specific question that pops in your mind throughout this conversation, please make sure you either send them to the group chat or to Sherry. She's going to be tracking them, and she'll let me know when we've got a question that needs to be answered. So please, we want to hear from you. We want to make sure that your questions get answered. So don't be shy. Throw those questions up in the chat, and we'll make sure that we get to as many of them as possible as we go on through this conversation. So Teresa, I want to ask you, you know, listening to this idea of how do we reimagine the festival season, you do a lot of work with different groups when it comes to permitting and working with these different stakeholders to navigate, you know, the civic system so that we can have a lot of these great events happen in our city. And so why do you think this is important to be having this conversation now? And how does that feed into the city's plans for what the 2021 festival season could look like?
Well, we know that 2020 has been nothing but unorthodox when it comes to what a festival season looks like. And every year we do need to get into planning what does our future look like, because we can't sit and wait for things to happen. We want to try and be in a situation where we're looking ahead. Again, to Patti's note, the notice from the province, the outlook isn't grim. It provides hope, but it does tell us that we are going to be in a situation where things will still have restrictions. And so we need to consider what is that going to look like. So as we look at the available spaces that we have and the resources that are going to need to be tapped to come together, this actually builds a great opportunity for us to start looking at where are those collaborative components that can tie in. Where are some of those opportunities that we've been looking for to find collaborations, to find new ways to engage citizens in a different level, whether it is encouraging them to not necessarily come down to one space, but how do we start to take it to the people and let them engage more? We're seeing a lot of intake and a lot of interest right now from community associations, especially a lot of these further areas in our city who don't necessarily see a lot of events on a regular basis. And how does that start to translate now in terms of opportunities that can start to grow and build upon the resources that exist in those different communities and those different potential partnerships that can start to develop? Because then that'll allow us as a city to start to reimagine kind of how it is that we're providing the services, what resources that we need to start pulling together, and how we can start to pivot to meet those demands and start to look at how we can provide different supports.
Thanks, Teresa. And Jennifer, some really great examples of, you know, different creativity or, you know, imagining how could you, you know, how could we look at an empty parking lot and turn it into something? And so kind of going off of that, and Teresa, you talked about, you know, this idea of collaboration and getting approached by, you know, these different BRZs and different stakeholders who want to collaborate, they want to do something in the space, they want to draw people into their communities. And so kind of bouncing off that, I'd ask all of the panelists, you know, how do you see those collaborations happening? And also how could you, I guess, how do you see the collaborations happening, and how do you actually see, you know, how could we activate these multiple areas throughout the festival season, and how would we actually be able to bring these folks together? So maybe, Patti, I'm gonna go to you. How would you see these different collaborations coming together, and how do you think it would actually work with reduced capacity, knowing that, you know, we're only gonna have potentially, and that's, you know, that's the high end in the fall, but, you know, scaling it back to the beginning of the season, how do you think you could imagine that working?
Well, I think part of the value to me of being able to have this conversation in this format is, if you look at myself and Teresa in particular, and now Jen in her role with the BIAs and the Downtown Association in particular, we have resources, we have assets, we have the opportunity to help facilitate adjustments and accommodations. So, you know, in my case, I'm a funder. And as we look at our funding for next year, we've got project grants, we've increased the envelope for the project grants. So we can try to help out where we can on how you pay for these collaborations and adaptations, right? For Jennifer, her resources and assets are space and venue possibility, and I think contribution from some of the BIAs who are in that position. And then of course with Teresa, we have seen a tremendous spirit of generosity and willingness, and you don't often hear that about a municipal government, to try and make it work. So a good example for this past summer was with patios in front of restaurants, right, and extending the patios out into the roadways. So you've got three people here who are willing to try to make your ideas work. What we aren't, and I'm using this term loosely, I know we all have produced festivals and probably continue to in our own lives, you are the producers and the presenters and the creators on the call. So you're the ones who have the ideas. So when Kaylee asks me, how would we do this? I'm more interested in how you would do it. And then you work with us and we try to figure out how to make it happen. But, you know, our initial idea, or one of the initial ideas that Jen and I talked to, is COVID has prompted much more of a focus on, rather than an audience coming to us in our venue, right? Whether it's outdoor or indoor. We now have to actually think about us going to the audience, to where they are, right? So if it's in the downtown and there are vacant parking lots, but we can't gather in big numbers, then how do we create that kind of movement from place to place to experience these unique arts offerings? So it is about inviting people to really kind of blow open your imagination to what's possible, and then bring those of us who might have assets and resources to offer or maybe amend into the loop early. Time is good. The more time, the more runway, it's better. And then of course, remembering collaborate, collaborate, collaborate. I know that it can be harder sometimes to do that, but we also have a limited pool of resources. So the more we can share in equipment, share in venue cost, share in artist cost, those kinds of things are going to help us stretch those dollars farther. And again, I would say this is probably a group of people who stretch the dollar as far as it can possibly go. So not so much the how as much as some tips or some things to think about as you come up with amazing ideas.
And I'll add to that to say that, and I'll speak maybe on Teresa from the city, but from my experience relating to the city this last year, is they've never been more open to help resolve a problem and collaborate than they have recently. And I will say that I think that attitude will extend into the future, and specifically 2021. This year, for example, we closed Stephen Avenue to vehicular traffic 24/7 for the first time in 30 years to accommodate extended patios for businesses. So what could that mean for festivals and events in the future? That we were always restricted from doing events down Stephen Avenue because of that, of the road closure there and the complex nature. Well, maybe now we just blow that door open. So there's people in place right now that are open to finding collaborative solutions, especially with the City of Calgary and heads of organizations, that the thought is different moving forward. And your large event occurs on Princess Island with six different stages. Well, what if that doesn't exist? What if it's six different festival hubs located in parking lots around downtown that people tour through? And so those are the options, that thinking of that in a different way is how success can still happen leading into 2021, I believe.
So Jennifer, I just want to, and then I'm going to go to Teresa, because I think we're getting into something really interesting about these different considerations to make these things happen in a safe way. And so Patti was talking about, you know, the movement of people, you know, to limited capacity and that continual movement in order to keep people safe. So we don't have a bunch of people coming and congregating in one place, which we all know is not the safest way to do things right now. And so I would ask you, because you've had some success doing this with the Inglewood Night Market, is how did you structure that? And then also to Teresa, you know, what are those considerations that festival organizers, event producers need to take into consideration to, you know, ensure that they're doing the right processes and connecting with the right people to make sure that their events are safe? So maybe Jennifer, if you can speak a little bit about how you manage that movement, some different ideas around that. And then Teresa, you know, what does it take to work with the city and the AHS guidelines to ensure that you're up to date on the protocols and you know what to do?
So I'll take off my downtown hat and put on my Inglewood hat right now. So we've run 7 successful Inglewood night markets during COVID. The first 4 were outside in September. So we rotated through 2 parking lots in Inglewood. Instead of being on the streets, we used 2 Calgary Parking Authority parking lots, who were more than willing to negotiate extremely good rates with us to use them. And we controlled our capacity by fencing them in, and limiting our capacity at the time was 200 people per site. And we actually ended up selling tickets for a 2-hour window instead of the entire event. So you bought a ticket from 3 till 5, from 5 till 7. And we sold those tickets and easily wristbanded people in different colors to identify their window. We weren't super strict. They stayed later, came early, just as long as we were able to maintain our capacity and health standards. We made people wear masks. We sanitized everywhere. We followed all the rules, but we were able to accommodate you know, per night, almost 2,000 people to run through our two sites, because we had two sites at 200. And then we made them walk in between the sites. So it was a block and a half in between the two parking lots. So they were able to circulate in between the sites. And that's how we did the outside, and it worked really well. And then we moved indoors for the month of November and found in Inglewood, and they exist everywhere in the city, actually, where we found a property owner with seven vacant retail bays all aligned next to each other. It was a brand new development and they hadn't been leased yet. There's some of them in Marteloup and other places. And we were able to lease all seven bays. And at the time it was 50 people could gather inside. Well, those seven retail bays were now 350 people. And as people, we had people wander in and out of each bay to be able to have their experience. And we had live music in one, which was filtered into the rest, or we, some nights we had the live music roaming in between the different bays. And so we continued to sell 2-hour shopping windows. And that was extremely successful as well. We almost pulled off our last final night, but we were put to the limit last Friday, where we had to unfortunately cancel. But those two models were extremely successful for us. And the vendors did extremely well. People came to shop and participate. We sold out, and of the seven night markets, we sold out every single one.
Thanks, Jennifer. And Teresa, so when people are, you know, planning their events and you know, either thinking of a different scale or moving them to different communities or having them rove, from a city perspective, what are some of those things that folks need to consider, and how is the best way for them to connect with your team or a team of the city to make sure they're navigating that properly?
Certainly. So, I mean, it's never an easy approach when we're hosting an event, and everybody knows that that has hosted an event in the past, because not only are you having to consider all of the elements around your venue, all of the necessary requirements that still are in place, plus the added need for additional requirements to meet AHS guidelines for COVID, that still fits into place. But then we also have to consider what are those community impacts as we start to look around outside that venue, because it is beyond just what we, you know, those four walls of a venue that you need to be looking through. And so that's where we start to look at who's in that surrounding area. Is it connected to a BIA? Are there supporting businesses in that area? Is there a community association? And who lives within that community that can start to build those relationships and start thinking about how people are traveling back and forth, how they're getting there, where they're parking, is there train and access, all of those things that are going to challenge those, what I call the threshold of tolerance of a community when we put events into them. People want them, but they also, there's a balance between the activity and their everyday lives. So it's having to take into those considerations. Of course, communication and marketing is going to be critical as we move forward. Everything from just people knowing what it is that they're coming to so that they feel comfortable and prepared to be a part of what's happening, but also that people in their neighborhood are aware that these are things that are happening so that they can either choose to attend or know how to respond when those things are occurring. Ways that we've been able to try to approach those or tack those in is by connecting, you know, through the city, through our event services at calgary.ca is an email for great information, our websites, but also, you know, utilizing some of those existing platforms that are in place to help bring some connection through. When you're doing your marketing, things like the Rise Up platform has been very successful in being able to send out information to people wanting to get out to events to occur in a safe manner, and other platforms and opportunities to work with media to get the information out there from a communication standpoint. But really, how we also have through our community neighborhoods groups, they're connected strongly with our community associations, and they're a great resource for us to be able to connect in to community newsletters and to start helping to connect, make some connections to find out where those interests are for more things to occur and how we can start to build those bridges to connect organizers with like-minded organizations who want to start to see things happening on a more regular basis.
Thanks for that, Teresa. You know, this is, it's so fascinating when you start to rethink of, you know, what could it look like? And I know Patti said, you know, we're on this call and we've got three folks here who have resources in one way or another. So if it's access through the city or it's, you know, space through the BRZ or a downtown association, or it's, you know, a support from our, you know, Calgary Arts Development. So I guess my question to our panelists would be, what is the best way for folks who are interested and they are thinking of things to do differently? And I will do a plug here. if you want to get collaborating with other people, please on riseupyyc.com. We've got a bunch of information there, including like AHS guideline protocols. My email's there, and I'm happy to connect you to whomever after this call. So you can use me as a resource. But asking our panelists, what is the best way for folks to connect with you or organizations like yourself to be able to try to explore how they could get these creative ideas off the ground so that we can have a, you know, a unique and creative 2021 festival season?
Well, I'll talk from a BIA perspective. If you go to calgary.ca and look up, search BIAs in Calgary, there's 12 of them currently, and they all have an executive director. And even though some of them may not have a lot of funds, they are really educated on the city and their community that they operate in, their business community, their needs in their community, their vacant space, their sometimes their landlords. They're a great connection and resource. It might not be for financial, some have more funds than others, but they all have people in place who are advocates for their area. And so tying into an advocate in an area, especially when it comes to venue, can be really helpful and provide a ton of cost savings. They might not be able to give you exact funds, but they might be able to find you free venues or free opportunities.
And certainly many of you may know, but some of you might not, calgaryartsdevelopment.com. If you go to our website, you'll see all of the grant investment programs that we have. For 2021, we will publish all of our granting programs in the first week of January, which is why I didn't put the link in the chat right now, because you won't see the programs for 2021. But know that we have a project grant program that has two deadlines next year. So that's an opportunity. For those of you who might be individual artists or maybe affiliated or organizations that are not considered not-for-profit, you're registered as a for-profit or a corporation as an example, some of our programs may preclude you if you apply on your own as a for-profit. However, this is where the partnership becomes really important, because if there's a not-for-profit organization, and there's 350 societies registered in the city of Calgary designated as arts society, so there's no shortage of arts organizations who could qualify for our grants. And, you know, and this is just a tip around grant writing. The more you can speak to partnership, the more you can speak to leveraging the resources that you have or that we can provide with other resources that you're going to get from your partnerships, that's going to make a stronger application. For those of you who maybe are working within what is often termed as equity seeking communities. We live in a time right now where we are encouraging what it means to be Canada's third most diverse city. We have a program called ArtShare, which has an open deadline. So if you have a really great idea of how we might show more of who Calgary is through festival, then the ArtShare program might be something. If you're an Indigenous artist, we have a program called the Original Peoples Investment Program. So we've tried to create a number of ways from a granting perspective to help. And then above and beyond that, you know, when Kaylee talks about Rise Up, or with the city of Calgary or Jen, we all talk with each other. And so if you have a really great idea, but you don't know who to call, we have staff at Calgary Arts Development to send us an email. And we probably can say, oh, you need to know Jennifer Rempel at the Calgary Downtown Association. And then we connect you up with one of her teammates. So those are ways that I hope we can help. We also try to represent the arts at a number of tables. So for example, civic partners are a group of organizations throughout the city who have a close relationship with the city of Calgary. If there's an idea that we think Tourism Calgary should know about, we will champion for that idea with Tourism Calgary and really ensure the arts are there. And the last thing I'll say is there are also other efforts underway that are about kind of creating these moments. So I'm picking on Jen today. The Calgary Downtown Association is putting on the Glow Festival in February, always looking for partners. In mid-January to the end of February, under the leadership of the City of Calgary and the Mayor's Office, Chinook Blast is coming up, looking for ways. While in Jen's on the steering committee. Oh, you really, it really is Jen day to day. So we also know about those things. We try to promote them and create awareness through our website, but that's the connecting and the bridging piece is also what we want to do. And I hope that you find ways to connect with, you know, all these people on this call today have an interest in festivals. And the participant list says there's 46 of us. That's a pretty good number to start finding partners with. Thanks.
If I could add to that too, just a little bit. So with the city, of course, on the Calgary.ca website, when you Google festivals and events, you get to our web pages, which provides a series of information from manuals for usage, but also the connecting to our team. And we have 6 coordinators that work to provide support for over 300 festivals annually. Although our subsidy program was already distributed for the year, there is opportunity to take a look at other ways we can start to support. We've got access to the various venues and working with those existing organizations who are utilizing those spaces and are talking to our coordinators around how they might want to pivot or change or find new opportunities within it. We also just closed a micro grant that was supporting additional costs towards COVID needs. We are working on right now a micro grant for winter events. So we're trying to find different ways that we can support the work that CADA is doing, as well as the work of all of the organizations that are out there trying to work hard to animate our city in different ways that we can pull this together. But if any time, if there's needing to talk through what an event might look like or how to utilize those spaces, even some of those logistic pieces, we do have a production team at the City of Calgary that works. They're building those annual events every year, whether it's Canada Day, or New Year's Eve, Culture Days. So they've got the hands-on experience from being producing events to be able to support you from a real time or connect you to other colleagues that can help kind of bring those pieces together. So an email to eventservices@calgary.ca is going to get you connected to the right people.
Thanks for that, Teresa, and to all of our panelists. So I'm just going to take a minute because we've had some great comments that are coming in the chat. So from, and I, if I say your name incorrectly, please forgive me and correct me when you have a chance to. But from Madan, taking arts to the community, our festival experimented this idea in 4 cities across Alberta. As Patti put it, we have to take our events to the community. Last year, our festival traveled to Southeast Calgary parking lot, same way they did it in Edmonton, Sherwood Park, and Fort McMurray. People love this idea and the response was great. So, you know, I pose this question to the panelists, I also want all of our viewers to really think about this as well. And if you have any examples of things that have worked for you, or you have something that's, you know, a question that's popped in your mind right now, you have access to these 3 very connected panelists. And so we want you to have the opportunity to use them and to get them to answer some of those questions. And I also want to hear these ideas. So, you know, from Rise Up and as a, you know, a community initiative and collaboration, we want to make sure the ball's rolling in the right direction. And so I would ask for you to think about that too. Take a minute for any questions you might have and make sure you send them to Sherry or put them in the chat so that we can get to those for our own use as well. What I would ask the panelists and to all of our viewers is, what are some of these really creative ideas we have seen so far that have worked really well that potentially we could use towards those summer months and or just something that, you know, you saw that really inspired you and you saw an opportunity there. So Jennifer, maybe let's start with you. I mean, you've already been able to, you talked about the empty parking lots, you've managed to do these successful night markets. What are some other creative examples you've seen Calgarians come up with in this strange time?
So you have seen a ton of pop-up markets and night markets kind of happen around the city, outside, flowing people through. I think the biggest thing for me is reimagining, because our park space will be maximized this next summer with people doing events, but at a small scale. And so how do we get outside and how do we spread around? And I have this real vision of the massive parking lots along 9th Avenue on the weekends is just becoming, as if we can spread them out because there's blocks and blocks and blocks of them, how we could maybe even temporarily transform them into, you know, with some permanent tent that was up all summer and groups just came in and used them, or how we could be advocates for that and listening to the ideas on what people need, or building these outdoor spaces that people could come use who would need it. So that's where my brain of the downtown is at right now, with providing amenity space for people to get creative and programming in. And really wondering what their need is to be able to hit go, and how can we provide assistance to those groups.
Thanks, Jennifer. Teresa, any specific ideas that really struck a chord with you that you thought, oh, that is super interesting, and I'd love to see this, you know, happen in this way, shape, or form?
Well, I know the success from the Telus Drive-In, that was a way to really come together and find a mechanism to create a safe space for people to come to, where it almost felt a bit turnkey that organizations could come and utilize it. Because I love, you know, where Jen's mind goes to and creating all these new opportunities, then my logic brain starts kicking in going, where are we getting the resources and how do we pull this together? Which means we need some runway to be able to figure those things out, because there is a solution for every problem. We've demonstrated that in the past and we'll continue to do that going forward. But if that means being able to go back to city administration and having those conversations about development permits and requirements, but also being able to reach out to the industry partners in the different sectors to figure out what is out there and how can we come together. Because with the Telus Spark, it was, you know, AV companies and production companies coming together and pulling everything that they had to try and make something work, and saw great success from it. And then organizations rallied around that, which I think is some of the things that we saw, those successes coming into place. And how do we start to look at creating some of those opportunities to make it a little easier or more turnkey, so that people can focus on the important pieces while ensuring we have safe opportunities? Because unless it's safe, people won't come out. We want to make sure that they feel that that's the way, and we can continue to grow that area that way as we start to open up the restrictions. And that will come as the province starts to release. You know, we were getting there until this wave two kicked us. We were starting to opening things up. You know, with our relaunch, we started with drive-ins and drive-throughs. And so we saw some interesting and creative ways, even at the Stampede grounds with the graduations and way people were responding to finding ways to still celebrate those moments in time and create those memories that they can carry with them. We'd opened it up then in our phase two with the community events and non-competitive walks and runs. And so we were getting ready to get to that next level when we got shut down. So I anticipate we're going to start to see a sort of a rollout again. And the more foundations that we can have in place that create a safe environment, the easier it's going to get us to be to each stepping stone and milestone along the way.
Thank you, Teresa. Patti?
These aren't so much things that I've seen, but, you know, when Patti sits up, and what are the things that keep me up at night, right? How do we continue to have live arts experiences and offer Calgarians an opportunity to experience the arts? And we saw at the beginning of the pandemic just how much Calgarians leaned on the arts, you know, whether it was watching online activities or picking up their guitar for the first time after 10 years, or their paintbrush to start that watercolor that they never got finished. So when we think about going to audiences, it is literally and figuratively, right? So it might be about someone being an audience member and watching something, but it could also be about participation, right? And I think one of the things that the pandemic does for me is creates that opportunity for you as artists and creatives to fill those moments of what are hard times for people right now, and be spontaneous in those random moments. So, you know, one thing I thought about, and I have no idea how you facilitate this, which is why all of you have signed in, because you know how to make it happen. Like, what if you had a walking art gallery in a neighborhood? And so at the beginning of the pandemic, Mandy Stobo, who's an amazing local artist, she did an image every day of something that was meaningful, and she invited young people to color it in and share it online. Well, what if you could get a hard copy of it printed on big sheets and you colored it in and you put it in your window or you put it out on your yard and you invited neighbors to walk around your neighborhood in this walking art gallery? And that maybe interspersed in that, you might have some of Calgary's most famous artists like Chris Cran or Ron Moffat or Paul Brandt, who also have their colored piece up there. So you can involve your neighborhoods. Matt Masters, who's an amazing musician, he started curbside concerts. So you could book Matt to do a concert on your driveway, and he showed up in his minivan because he's a dad. And he set up a stage on top of his van and put, and it was him and his speaker, and he performed a concert for 12 people who came and sat on your front yard. So there are those kinds of things. Teresa talked about the running, like races. How are we going to do road races again? Well, what if every stop had a performance? Or a festival scavenger hunt? And you had to travel in your car with your cohort to find these festival moments throughout the city that remind us of what our festival scene is like. You know, Edmonton talks about being a festival city. Calgary actually has more festivals than Edmonton. We're the festival city in the province. So I think there are lots of those kinds of ways that, you know, again, for me, it was, well, how do we get to them? How do we go to where they are, to where they feel safe and comfortable? In the summertime, those patios are extended and there's people there. You have a captive audience. How do you travel from patio to patio within any given BIA? So we already know people are there and we already know they feel safe. So how can you add to that experience? And then the last thing I think of, and I think Paul might actually be on the call, Paul Magnuson, who was the big art drive-in guy, mastermind at TELUS. There were movies for sure, but he also did live performances. And the one I attended, the Rise Up Weekend, had six slots and six different festivals programmed the six different slots. So again, Calgarians got to have a feel for those festivals that they didn't get to attend in person like they normally would have. So is there something there that could be expanded or worked on in a different kind of way for the year ahead? That would be some ideas I thought about.
So I'm just going to kind of go off, you know, I think we've got time for one more question, and then I'm going to open it up to general questions from our viewers. And then that would really be your chance to be able to pick the minds of these very talented and intelligent ladies. So just speaking into safety, and you said, Patti, you know, like keeping people safe and that feeling of safety. And so, you know, and Paul, if you're on the call, feel free to maybe message Sherry and we can get you to jump in you know, how did you make people feel safe? And what did you think was important in considering to you know, make sure that people were feeling comfortable to come down and experience these things in a safe way? And I know, Jennifer, you have a really great story about how you structured ticketing so that you could do contact tracing. And so maybe talk about a little bit about that and that the importance of making sure people feel safe and how you can do that.
So when we ventured into the Inglewood Night Market, that was our first and foremost was public safety and safety, not only of our the people attending, but also our participants, the artisans who participated and the artists, as well as the staff. So that was, you know, first and foremost that we were looking out for everybody. And so we determined right away that it was mask mandatory, tons of hand sanitizer, but it's that contact tracing and making people know that we were, you know, taking all of the requirements, even the recommendations, not the requirements, but even the recommendations into account with Alberta Health Services. So we went through a full implementation plan and we came quickly to believe that we needed to contact trace. Well, how can you effectively and quickly contact trace people? And so well, the only way is to get them to sign up. And so if you get them to sign up, sometimes they won't show up, and then that leaves a spot that someone else can't take. And so that's where we started this 2-hour window of an experience instead of a whole evening of experience. And so we thought it was risky, and then we added a $5 cover onto it, but we partnered with Music Mile and said we will be giving half the proceeds back to Music Mile and keeping the rest to run our event and pay our staffs and suppliers. And so surprisingly, people really engaged in that, and they didn't mind giving back. And so I think that's the other thing, is people, attendees who live in the city, who love the arts, will engage more and will engage in a different way if you ask them to. We felt that at the Inglewood Night Market and have been inspired to do things differently because of that.
Awesome. I don't know if we've got Paul or Rob in the queue, but if they are, I'd be happy to have them speak to a little bit about what they've done to help make people feel safe. And then before we get to that, I just wanted to answer a quick question that came up in the thread was, there should be one place to find resources, venue, permit, funding options. Is this possible on the Rise Up YYC page? Definitely, we can explore to throw those links up, at least to help direct you in the direction you need to go. We currently have an AHS guideline protocol sheet on the riseupyyc.com landing page, where you can click on that, and it gives pretty detailed instructions on how you navigate to work with AHS to ensure that you're following the protocols or you're getting a special approval that's suitable for your event. And I know that Rob has a really great experience working with them as well as Paul. And so if Rob or Paul are maybe available, we've worked a lot with them as far as in collaboration with Rise Up and this initiative. So if you want to talk about safety and or your collaboration with Rise Up and maybe what collaborations meant to you, I'd invite you to chime in.
Rob, do you want to go? I spoke last time, so I feel like everyone's sick of hearing me from the last relaunch.
Yeah, sure. Hey, everybody. Nice to gather here, you know, creatively as a collective to share our ideas and project forward what the future could look like for all of us. So thanks for including me and bringing this all together. I was, you know, this spring launched an initiative here called Hotels Live. And prior to that, I'd run my own entertainment agency called Live Star Entertainment Canada. We started up July 1st at the Ramada Plaza, Calgary downtown with this concept. It turned out to be the first live in-person concert in Canada. And we were positioned ourselves that way to be first out of the gate with this. And we brought a Tragically Hip tribute into play on Canada Day. We ended up running 15 safe live concert events from July 1st to October 31st, and 48 artist performances took place. We sold out a number of our events, and over 5,000 Calgarians came through those doors and experienced live music in person, as close as we could do before, prior to COVID. So over 1,300 hotel rooms. And each week we held a concert, you know, nearly 400 people in attendance, you know, making it Canada's largest attended concerts each time. So we did this all, you know, I summed it up just recently, and proud to say that we did it all COVID free, with zero reported cases of COVID-19, which for us, is a great achievement and a proven model for us, not only here to use moving forward in Calgary, but, you know, across Canada and beyond, as far as being able to roll out these types of events in a safe way. And, largely because it's naturally situated where everyone is socially distanced, watching these shows from the hotel balconies. So we would set up on a pool deck and produce concerts from there. We would over message and communicate to a number of our attendees regularly about all the COVID protocols that were in place, and you know, people were really good. They partook and they listened, and I emceed a lot of our events, and I preached a lot, kind of almost gospel-like, about our achievements and how we're supporting local economy, the local economy for the arts and hotel and hospitality sectors. And you know, it was sort of a organically grown, you know, people just coming back more and more, and you know, in some cases people in tears because they were able to experience live music in no other way. And in some ways even better, because they had a private box suite and a private washroom. They could bring their own food and beverage if they liked, or they could order the room service there from the hotel, and they could enjoy entertainment with their children, their families, their cohorts, their bubbles, and sing, dance openly right there, all gathered together. So the experience itself was very unique, and we continue to, you know, move in that direction now, pivoting indoors with the the Delta Calgary South Hotel here in Calgary, where it's an atrium complex. And we've received also approval from Alberta Health Services to, you know, roll out our events there with the success that we've been able to attain. We kicked off on Halloween with a dance Halloween party from Amp Radio, and it was a sellout. And we've recently announced our first live show, which is a Pink Floyd tribute on December the 19th. And that sold out as of today. And we rolled into a second show today for the Friday, December 18th. We're looking forward to announcing something for New Year's Eve and then continue this throughout the winter months. And we built a beautiful stage there over top of a swimming pool, and 36 foot by 24 foot that could accommodate a variety of, you know, types of shows. We're open to doing, you know, dance events, theatrical performances, instrumentals. I mean, comedy on top of, you know, live entertainment. So we're open to, you know, bringing people into this facility now and seeing how we can continue to expand, bringing live music experiences and live entertainment experiences to the masses, I guess, in this case, where we can, at this point, we can hit 200 people at the Delta. And we have plans to open up a ground level area, which is part of their open air restaurant, to give us another 100 people. So, you know, up to 300 people can gather at any one time, you know, beyond any gathering limits, because they are naturally socially distanced on their balconies. So we're excited. I love the conversation where this is going. I'd like to also say we have plans to work with other hotel properties on this hotel balcony concept for the spring, not only here, but right across Canada. And I could see us, you know, working in tandem with a festival where we could be a hub at, say, the Calgary Ramada Plaza property, and also be a hub at Hotel Arts.
Rob, I just want to jump in, because you've done so much, and I this is a really good time to segue into that. Our next Relaunch Lunch is going to feature Hotels Live and the format and the model they have used that has been so successful. And so really, we are going to send details for that Relaunch Lunch shortly after this one. And so Rob, thank you so much and for doing that and for all this great information here today. We did have one other question that came in from...
We have one from Miguel. Miguel Cortinas has got his hand raised there, Kaylee. Oh,
okay. Do you know...
Miguel, do you want to come on screen and ask your question if you're
sure.
Willing and able?
Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much for the opportunity, and congratulations for the panel. It's really, really exciting to see so many talent in event producing and community organizations. And just to share, we are based here in CS Space King Edward. This is a beautiful, magnificent space that we have in our city. It's a hidden treasure, basically. And we have organized, Casa Mexico have organized some events here in the summer. We organized a movie night. It was a great success, very safe. It was like probably 80 people in the park. it's a beautiful park, and I think there is a lot of opportunity to do more things here at Sea Space. There is a small theater here as well, very, very safe as well. As soon as the regulations come to place, I think there is a great opportunity. And as I mentioned, this is a hidden treasure, beautiful space. And hopefully we can have more activity here in the building because it's very worth for the community around and to have a small events and very safe events as well. Thank you.
Awesome, thanks so much. And sorry, Rob, you have so much great information. I don't want you to give away all of our information for our next relaunch.
Yeah, I tend to ramble a little bit. I'm pretty excited about the project, and we'll save it for the next session. But I will say one more thing is how the collaboration is coming together between Rise Up and the city and Hotels Live, where, you know, I am a for-profit, so and not used to working with, you know, city, you know, other city entities. So I'm really happy to be, you know, amongst all of you and learning how to collaborate together so we can all, you know, literally rise up together here. So I'm open to working with everybody in whatever ways we can come together, and we'll have facilities for everyone, you know, and look forward to doing it.
Well, and that's such a great segue to Rob, because, you know, that's what Rise Up is about. And so if you're looking to connect with other people and you want to share ideas, please learn more about what we're doing at Rise Up. RiseUpYYC.com. And, you know, we have some resources that we're using to help amplify what you're doing. And so whether it's through our listings and event page or helping you connect to hotel partners to create vacation staycation packages, or even just connecting to other creatives so that you can come up with different festival ideas or reimagine how you could work together. You know, we really do wanna kind of create this place where we can get creative and support each other. Are there any more questions, Sherry?
I don't see anyone's hand raised or in the chat box here. If anyone wants to add anything, feel free to jump in.
And no worries, you know, this has been a great conversation, and thanks for joining us on your lunch hour. I would just maybe ask our panelists if you have any final thoughts for us, and you can send us all on our merry way, because I know we're all busy reimagining how we continue to, you know, ride this wave.
Well, certainly from Calgary Arts Development's perspective, we thank you all very much for joining us. Again, we're always looking for those ways that we can partner and help amplify the work of artists and other creatives in the community. So we love to hear from you. Please bear with us. It might take us a little while to respond, but we certainly won't ignore you. And again, I think among the three organizations that you see represented here and our various networks, our arms extend wide and large. So if we don't know you, please make sure that one of us does, so that we can champion for you when we get involved and invited to participate on other initiatives. And then one last thing that Rob made me think about is I've heard that on the staycation packages, there are some hotels that if you are broadcasting or you're sharing your work online, they actually have a way of streaming it to the TV in the hotel room. So if it's part of a staycation package and it's not Rob and you're not watching the stage live, but you're broadcasting from some other venue, they can actually watch it on the TV in the hotel room. So there are these kinds of technology and technical innovations that are happening. And then the last thing I would just ask Kaylee and Sherry is I see in the chat box, there's a number of people who have said, hey, we'd love to help or partner up. Here's my email. So just making sure that there's a way that everybody on this call can access that information. Maybe it's through the Rise Up platform or something, I don't know. But thank you very much for having me.
I'll speak just quickly to what Patti said. After this relaunch lunch, we have some returning guests from our previous relaunch lunch, so we will send a note. And if you'd like to be added to, you know, our ongoing communication, so you're in the loop about when we're hosting these things, then feel free to just let us know to keep you in the loop. Also, I put my email in the chat. It's Kaylee at birdcreatives.com. please connect with me. I am happy to share any resources that we have and connect you with anyone that's within my network. And also the riseupyyc.com, that has a lot of information on it as well. You can see the current listings. If you have something happening, please submit it there. Also, my contact is there, so you can always contact me with any specific questions that you have. So I'll be sure to keep you in the loop with our ongoing efforts. Maybe we'll go to Jennifer and then Teresa.
Great. I just wanted to thank you for having me here and speak today. And just on behalf of the Downtown Association, it is part of our new mandate to connect with arts organizations and the festivals and events that are here in a greater way than we've done in the past. So anyone who's doing anything downtown or thinking about downtown, please feel free to reach out to us. As well, we have a brand new website with an events page that needs populated. So anything that you have going on, at minimum, we'd like to promote what's happening and promote to our audience of your activities. So how we can be a resource to you in any way, please feel free to reach out to myself or my team.
Awesome. Teresa, and then I'm going to throw to Sherry to wrap us up.
Sure. So again, you know, necessity is the mother of invention, and that's definitely what we're hoping to see as we move forward, hoping people aren't afraid to step outside their comfort zone, and we're going to try and meet you halfway so we can get you through to the finish line to see things happen, whether that's new collaborations with sport and art and all those things that can we haven't seen in the past that we can start to try new and creating those new relationships and pieces. So happy to connect and have those conversations with people who are looking for some support or some guidance, or just to be able to riff some ideas, and we'll see what we can do to try and move things along. Again, you always have to be a little patient with us at the city. We have a long runway we have to walk down, but we're willing to walk down there together. So appreciate the opportunity to have this conversation, and look forward to seeing all the amazing things that 2021 will bring. So thanks, ladies. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Teresa.
And I think that wraps us up for this particular event. I just want to thank everyone, all of our panelists, Patti, Jennifer, Teresa, Kaylee, for moderating all the questions, and everyone here for being witness today. Thanks for sharing your stories, your ideas. There's a lot of wonderful creative things going on in this city, and we're happy to have this opportunity to chat about them. As we got a taste of, Rob is going to be one of our panelists on the next Rise Up Relaunch Lunch, which is going to be happening on December the 17th. Registration for that is already open, and we'll look forward to talking about the balcony concerts concept, hotel partnerships, how those work, some new ways of looking at bringing arts into different types of venues, and how artists can utilize those ideas moving forward. So we hope that everybody will be able to join us December the 17th as we look to collaborate together and continue the conversation. So we'll look forward to seeing you then. In the meantime, be safe, be well, and have a great rest of your day. Thanks so much, everybody. Bye for now.